And I'm thrilled to introduce Jane Kosloff, who is a licensed clinical social worker and a perinatal mental health specialist. She's going to share more about herself and her practice and the topic that we're here to talk more about. Jane, it's all yours.
Great. Hello. Good morning. So happy you all are here. I am going to go ahead and get the slides up and we will go from there. So let me take a moment to do that and make that full screen. And let me adjust one more thing and I should be good to go. Okay. All right, well again, really glad that you're all here today. My name is Jane Kosloff and like Nia said, I'm a licensed clinical social worker. And today our topic is gonna be supporting parents with ADHD during pregnancy and postpartum. And it's an overview and there's gonna be a lot of practical support strategies mentioned here. Oops. Sorry, it is not letting me move forward as I thought it would. Okay, it should be fine. Okay, sorry, I'm gonna close one. I'm just gonna readjust the screen for a second to make sure I can click forward in a way that's not gonna be disruptive. Let me just test that real quick. Yeah, it's okay. All right, so again, I'm Jane Kosloff. I'm a licensed clinical social worker. I've worked in community mental health settings and primary care settings. I'm in private practice now. And in my practice, I focus on supporting perinatal clients, particularly around anxiety and trauma, and adults with ADHD, you know, many perinatal clients who have ADHD. I'm also an EMDR consultant in training. And EMDR is a modality to work with trauma, and I consult with clinicians who are either learning that or getting certified. And then I have ADHD myself.
Do you
want to
go out?
I'm sorry? Sorry, I think that was just background. And I have ADHD myself, and that's part of what brings me to be interested in this topic and have some lived experience that I'm bringing to the table. So before I move forward, I want to give just a little information on just some logistical elements today that I have this divided into three sections. And at the end of each section, I have room to ask some questions, but I am open to having questions asked during the presentation if there's parts that are unclear or just something really on your mind. If that's the case, feel free to just pop on and we can talk about it then. The chat is always a great option as well. I'm only going to be looking at the chat at those times, but you're welcome to pop a question in the chat at any point. All right. So here is the agenda for today for the webinar. Again, there's three sections. The first one is going to be learning about adult ADHD, that I'm wanting to give us a foundation around what adult ADHD is, what it looks like, because adult ADHD is something where there's kind of a lot of at least talk in the cultural zeitgeist around it. And I just want to get us on the same page around what that looks like. The second section is learning common difficulties that arise when people with ADHD become pregnant or have babies. And the idea of this webinar is that these sections are going to layer on each other. So the third section is some strategies that are focused on supporting pregnant and postpartum people who have ADHD. And so the idea is we'll learn about, you know, adult ADHD in general, what that looks like during pregnancy and postpartum, and then strategies to help support people that are focused around ADHD. All right, so before we jump into some more of the material, I'm wanting to let everybody know about a lens that I see ADHD through. I'm not gonna go into a ton of detail, but partially to at least kind of have a sense of where I'm coming from when I talk about ADHD, that I work from the neurodiversity affirming approach. The neurodiversity affirming approach encompasses a lot more than ADHD, that it's really talking about a lot of different things being part of biodiversity. And it's looking at valuing lived experience, moving away from it really looks like autism, and taking that into account one element that I want to mention that will show up a little bit is also around language that comes from the neurodiversity affirming approach and preferences. And that is identity first, first person, first language. That although this webinar is about ADHD, also going to be bringing up autism here or there for reasons you'll see as we get going. And with that, that there's a preference for a lot of people with autism to be called an autistic person or to be called an autistic person rather than ASD, someone with autism. So that's the term that I'm going to go with for here. So when you hear that, I just wanted some knowledge of why I'm choosing to use that term. And for ADHD, people with ADHD, I've seen less of a preference overall that some people, you know, are okay with someone with ADHD. Some people prefer being called an ADHDer. So I'll kind of use both at different times in the presentation. I do want to note that it's always going to be what matters the most is always going to be somebody's preference. So I'm going with what there's a lot of, what there seems to be kind of agreement within these communities of preferences, but what an individual wants is always going to matter more than kind of what the larger kind of community sees and talks about sometimes. So just a note on language there. And that's, again, just kind of the lens that I see ADHD through and that I'll be talking through as we go. So that brings us to the first section, which is, what is adult ADHD? I give an overview for each section to know where we're going. And I'm going to start with briefly talking about the DSM-5 definition. And the DSM-5 is a diagnostic and statistical manual. It's the big guide that is used for diagnosing various mental health conditions. I'm not going to be going into a ton of detail about it, but the idea is to give some sense of when somebody has ADHD, like what are some things that that are looked at. Certainly not giving a guide to diagnosing or anything like that, but it's just a little bit of getting a flavor of what that's like. And I do want to mention that I just talked about kind of the neurodiversity affirming approach. The DSM is generally not considered affirming. It's within the medical model and is symptom-based. But I think, again, it's important to know kind of where that is, because if people are getting a formal diagnosis, that's what that's going to be based on. From there, I'm going to move into talking about executive functioning and executive functions, explain what that is, and talk about what that can look like with adult ADHD. And then I'm going to move on to talking some about medications and a little bit about like ADHD and medications with pregnancy and postpartum. So that's where we're going in this section. And one more note before we jump in. It's something to know with ADHD is that there's
also called blazing.
One thing to also know with ADHD is that there's a lot of different traits and dimensions to it. And with that, there's a variety of different ways that that can look for somebody, that there's all these different traits. And then there's kind of how that shows up for somebody or how strong it is, however you want to think about it, looks different, which means that like no two people with ADHD are going to have exactly the same experience, that there's going to be some traits that somebody with ADHD has, another person doesn't have at all, or some are going to be stronger or does not show up in the same way. And, you know, to make it ADHD, there has to be enough things that are similar that, you know, we cluster these traits in a way that if enough of them show up, that's what we call ADHD. But I bring it up to know that it's not a monolith by any stretch, and what somebody needs is going to be still individual. And that these are given as we go with these explanations and suggestions, that it's really going to be looking at, you know, who is in front of you, who you're talking to, who you're working with, to see what's going to be most helpful. So here is this page from the DSM. I am not going to read the whole thing, so don't worry about that, because it's a lot of words and you do not need to read the whole thing, but I'm going to skim through just to give a sense of things. So in the DSM, it divides these experiences into two categories. There's the inattentive symptoms and the hyperactive or impulsive ones. I'm just going to skim through on the inattentive side. I'm going to read some of these bolded words to just give a sense of the sort of things that come up or that are looked at. careless mistakes, trouble holding attention, does not seem to listen, doesn't follow through on instructions, trouble with organizing tasks and activities, losing things, getting distracted, being forgetful. Moving to the hyperactive, impulsive side, there's fidgeting, leaving the seat, running around or climbing in situations where not supposed to be doing that, having difficulty with being quiet, being on the go, talking excessively. I don't know exactly what excessively means, but you know, it's there. Blurting out an answer, difficulty waiting a turn, interrupting or intruding. And with a diagnosis, can move to this next one, that someone would be, if someone has kind of the meets enough of those different criteria, they would be told they have a certain presentation. So it would either be just inattentive, just hyperactive, impulsive, or combined presentation. And a couple of notes there. One is that that word presentation was used purposely, that I think it used to be thought of more as a type, that if somebody has interactive or inattentive type, then that's the type they have. That's a type that, again, that won't change. And that's not how it's thought of anymore. That can change during the lifespan. It's meant to be, this is how this is showing up now. This is the presentation now. And with those three presentations, the combined presentation of both of those is what is the most commonly diagnosed by a lot. One thing to also keep in mind around kind of the diagnosis is looking at this concept of trait versus state. And that means that these sort of things that we're talking about and the other things that we'll see as we go are elements that are there for somebody like all the time. It may look different on different days or depending on what's going on in their life, but it doesn't go away 100%. And part of why I mention that is, especially as I kind of talk about some of the other things moving forward, is most of the things, if not everything with ADHD, are things that a lot of people are going to experience at some point in their life in some way. And like, especially when we're having a hard time, there are going to be elements that we see that are similar that can show up for somebody. But if that goes away like 100%, like when life changes or they get more support or things are easier, then it's just probably not ADHD. It's probably something else. So that trait is just really speaking to that it's something that's always there in some way or another. Another thing just to know is that, you know, with the DSM, that it'd be something that would start in youth. And then a few notes here of around kind of where things are going and some issues around diagnosis. As far as where things might be heading, there's a lot of energy around researchers and people who are very established kind of in the ADHD world to make changes both around the criteria and to potentially even change the name. There's a lot of people who feel like even the name is not accurately describing what ADHD is all that well. And the other element is if you look at some of these criteria so these are the same criteria for adults and children. And if you look at it, you can tell it leans more towards kids. It's just less likely that you're gonna have an adult that's going to start climbing something at a time when they shouldn't, right? That would be very unusual. So things like that, you can see that this is written more towards children. And it was also written more towards boys. They have edited pieces or added little pieces here or there, but there's not a separate criteria for adults than kids right now. And there are people who are making an argument that there should be, that there might be more accurate criteria for adults and children. And with knowing that, just wanting to mention, I don't know how well known it is, but there's right now also kind of in the cultural air, if we might say, debate around people self-diagnosing, kind of learning what ADHD is and thinking, yeah, that really fits me. And there's like, you know, debates around if that's valid or not. And part of what I'm wanting to bring in is like, we know like the criteria here, like it has changed over time. These criteria are not meant to be static. They're meant to change with research and knowing more around kind of what these things really look like. So I just bring that in that from my perspective, and I know this is a controversial viewpoint, that I think self-diagnosis, you know, can be fine. There's a lot of barriers to getting diagnosed. It can be expensive. And sometimes even if people actually have it, they may not actually get diagnosed in an assessment. There's just a lot of complicated elements to it. And it doesn't represent everybody as well. It doesn't represent women as well. It doesn't represent BIPOC people as well. And the other point that I want to mention for here, for this presentation, is that, I mean, I'll talk about medication a little bit, but everything else here can be used to help support somebody, whether they have a diagnosis or not. It just doesn't really matter. Like, they're all sort of just different ideas that people can try. And if they're helpful, that's great. So bring it up because somebody's saying, oh, like, you know, I think I might have ADHD, but I'm not sure. You know, for these strategies, you could still try them and see. It just doesn't really matter if they're diagnosed or not for all these sort of strategies. Okay, so we're going to move on from the DSM criteria onto some different other ways to kind of think about ADHD. One of them is looking at executive functioning. And this, I like this definition here, which is executive function is a cognitive process that organizes thoughts and activities, prioritizes tasks, manages time efficiently, and makes decisions. So you can see that executive function or functioning covers a lot of like internal processes around kind of organizing thoughts and elements like that. And then again, prioritizing how we use time, all sorts of things like that. And I'm gonna go into a little bit of detail around a few of them here, a few executive functions and how sometimes they can look with ADHD, you know, for some people. So a big one is working memory differences. And working memory is short-term memory. So, you know, it's not that people with ADHD would have trouble remembering things in the past, but it is that short-term memory that can be tricky at times. So an example, and this is one that most people can relate to at some point in their life, but it's walking into a room, right? And then having no memory of why you walked into the room. It's like, I know I walked in here for a reason, but cannot remember why, right? And then maybe an hour later, you realize why you came into the room. The next one that I'm going to talk about here is sustained attention. And that is related to focus. An example I would give here is, say somebody is wanting to check their email on their phone. They get on their phone, but then, and they see it, and then, you know, they see the Instagram icon and they're like, oh yeah, I really wanted to check this one account. I'm just going to do that. And then I'm going to get back to the email. I can take a second and do that. But then when they get on to Instagram, they look at that account and then they end up scrolling and forget what they were actually doing on the phone. They're like, oh yeah, I'm just looking at Instagram. Then at some point, say 20 minutes later, they remember, oh, I was actually trying to check my email and get back to that. And a point to know here is that it wasn't a choice of, oh, I'm just going to take a break and go on Instagram before I check my email. It's like getting kind of derailed that, oh, I'm doing this other thing. And it takes a while to remember what the goal was in the first place. And then response inhibition is related to impulsivity. And impulsivity can show up in different ways. It can show up through actions. It can show up through words. So an example that I have here is more of a verbal one. And this would be, so someone with ADHD is having a conversation with somebody, and maybe they're really excited about that conversation. They might feel like, oh, like they know the end of that the sentence the other person's going to say, and they end up just jumping in before the person finishes their sentence because they're excited, and they end up interrupting. And then afterwards, they might kind of realize like, oh, you know, it would have felt better to me to wait until they were done with their sentence. But it came from that impulse of to talk now. And again, it's around that impulsive element of that there's not that time between kind of the thought and the action. It's an urge and then it happens. Okay, so here are some other elements. Some of these would be classified as executive functions. Some of them not. I'm just kind of lumping a bunch of them here that I all think are useful ways to think about ADHD. So the first one is differences in motivation. that within the ADHD community, people talk about the idea of having an interest-based nervous system versus an importance-based nervous system. And that means that when there's something that needs to get done, what gets prioritized is what's interesting versus what's important. And it's not a choice of looking at it and being like, oh, I'm gonna just choose to do the interesting thing because the other thing is boring. It gets very hard to start something that is less interesting, even if they know this is important. There's gonna be a consequence if I don't do this thing. There's a deadline, but it's just much harder to get started. And the importance is just not as motivating as it is to people without ADHD. Another part that's related around motivation is task initiation. So that is, you know, getting started with tasks. An example that I like to give of what this can look like, which can also illustrate that ADHD can feel very differently internally than how it looks on the outside. So it can be like, you know, somebody gets home and they're like, I'm gonna do the dishes, but I'm just gonna rest for a second. But, you know, they sit down, they wanna do the dishes, they start getting on their phone and scrolling and doing all that. And then they keep thinking of like, I should really do the dishes. I know I would feel a lot better if I did the dishes. I know I told, you know, my partner that I would do the dishes, all these things. And then it does either doesn't end up happening or doesn't end up happening for hours, that it's really hard to get started with that task. Usually with something that is, you know, not the most interesting or can be something kind of mundane where this shows up, but internally that person is not feeling great about not starting it. They want to, it's just not happening. So from the outside, it can look like, oh, they just decided to be on their phone instead of doing the dishes, but that's not really what's happening internally. So another difference in sensing time. This is sometimes called time blindness. And that's having a different internal sense around time and not being able to sense it moving in the same way that other people can. So it can be, you know, doing an activity and really getting lost in it and then realizing that a lot more time has passed than they realized. Another element with this is that for some people, they can be late to, you know, appointments or activities. And it can go the other way, that because there's that tendency and people know that, that they overcompensate and are anxious about being late and they're always early because they put a lot of effort and energy into it and they're always worried about it. So people with ADHD are not always late. You do see people also who are anxious around being on time, and they are, but they put effort into it and they're worried about it. There's also differences in emotional regulation. This is one that has been seen in the ADHD community, and research in the last 10 years or so is seeing now as well. And this can show up as having some big emotions from things. It also is related to, there's a concept called rejection sensitive dysphoria, which can be having a lot of difficulty around rejection or criticism, which can be quite impactful. Another element that I'm just wanting to mention here is around hyperactivity. Because when we think of hyperactivity and we think of a child, oftentimes that activity is going to be visible. You're going to see them moving around or wiggling in their seat or any of those sort of things. But for adults, most of the time, you're not going to see the actions. They're going to be feeling it internally as internal restlessness. And internal restlessness is generally an uncomfortable feeling that feels similar to anxiety. It's a different origin, because with anxiety, there's some sort of worry or fear, and then the body reacts in that way. But with this, it's just this feeling that the physical feeling is similar to anxiety, and it can be uncomfortable. And then the last piece I'm going to mention here is around sensory differences. This is also a piece that is not always thought of as being connected to ADHD, but it's another one that within the ADHD community is seen very, very frequently. And also research is showing that as well, that there have been studies that have been suggesting that sensory differences may actually be a pretty big component of ADHD, and particularly in AFAB in women. So it is something that I'm going to be mentioning throughout, because being aware of those sensory differences and being able to attend to those can make a big difference. Okay. So I also want to mention some co-occurring conditions that happen with ADHD, that 80% of people with ADHD have at least one co-occurring condition. And I'm gonna list, you know, go through some examples here, but part of why I'm mentioning it is to know that, you know, so 80%, most people with ADHD, there's another element that is going on that could potentially be making things difficult. And the list is much longer than this. I just wanted to give a few examples. So some things that are correlated are learning differences. So for example, dyslexia or dyscalculia. Dyslexia is around reading, dyscalculia is around numbers and math. Anxiety and depression rates are very high. OCD, trauma, bipolar disorder as well occur more for people with ADHD than in the general population. Autism has a very high co-occurring rate. I didn't put a number here because I was having trouble kind of nailing that down. The studies vary so much, but it is a high number. And it's the other direction as well, that that autistic people also have a really high rate of having ADHD. And there are folks with ADHD as well that have autistic traits that it may not meet the diagnosis, but there are some similarities. The last thing that I'm going to mention here is that there's also medical conditions that are highly correlated with ADHD. One of them are eye muscle teaming issues. It's one that I happen to have, so I know a little bit about. Like the one I have is called convergence insufficiency. And the way it shows up is that when I read, if I don't have glasses that can help in a way with that, that I get tired, I get headaches and things like that. And like that can mimic what a learning disorder or difference can look like. Hypermobility conditions are also higher in people with ADHD than they are otherwise. So as you can see, there's just a lot of different pieces that could be at play. And there are a lot of people who have more than one co-occurring condition going on with ADHD as well. Okay, so with the medication component, I'm going to briefly go over some pieces here. You know, I'm a clinical social worker, I'm not a prescriber. So I'm not gonna go into a ton of detail, but I think it is important to know some background. For ADHD, there's two types of medications. There's stimulants and there's non-stimulants. The stimulants are the ones that a lot of people know about, like Adderall and Ritalin. And then there's, you know, a variety of non-stimulant options as well. For the stimulants, there's all sorts of different dosing and things available. Like there's ones that last just a couple hours, there's ones that are extended release and can last the whole day. So there's some variety of choices around medication supporting people with ADHD. And what I hear from people when they take medications, and I'm thinking a little bit more about the stimulant medications right now, is that when they take it, that their brain feels quieter. Sometimes people say that their brain is quiet for the first time in their life. For other people, it doesn't make their brain quiet, but it's quieter or slows it down. And slowing it down really helps with being able to plan, being able to have a little more choice of feeling like what they do with their day to be able to get more done if they're wanting to get more done. And there are some people who also feel calmer in their body. And I believe that's related to that hyperactivity, inner restlessness. So sometimes when people take stimulant medications, it can have a feeling that can feel like an anti-anxiety effect. Because it may not have really been anxiety, but it felt like that. So it can have some really big impacts. And non-stimulants can be really helpful as well. I'm a little less familiar with them, which is why I'm not going into as much detail here right now about them. So when we look at this, I'm like, okay, you know, medications can be really helpful for people. What happens when someone with ADHD becomes pregnant? Or, you know, with lactation after giving birth. You can see I wrote the same thing for both of these, but I'm gonna go into a little more detail. And that there's limited research, talk to a prescriber. And when I was going through and seeing like, what is the current, you know, messaging around it, that right now, that there's not enough evidence one way or another, at least for the most part. to say that somebody should or should not stay on medications, ADHD medications, when they're pregnant, or when they are feeding their baby, when they're just feeding their baby. And that it really needs to be a discussion with their prescriber around that of what's going to be the right choice there for them. And that is because it's really hard to do studies in this area. It's hard to do studies with pregnant people and just feeding people and, you know, change these variables. It's just
your voice just cut out.
Oh, my voice cut out? Can you still not hear me?
We can hear you pretty good. There's a little bit of latency, but we're getting most of the words even when there is.
Okay. Please let me know if it continues and I can see if there's anything I can change. Is it sounding okay now?
Yeah.
Okay. Definitely let me know if there's any sound issues as we go. Okay. So that's the main message there, is that that would be a conversation. But it's not something, there's not a recommendation of absolutely not taking the medications either. And of course it'd be individual depending on the person's situation and any health conditions they have and, you know, things like that. Okay. So go ahead and take a break and answer some questions if there are any, and I can take a look at the chat as well. If there is a question, if anyone wants to jump on to ask a question, feel free. Otherwise I will take a look at the chat, see where we are. Okay. Looks like more just kind of technical questions. Okay. Unless I'm not seeing any questions here, that would be for me. Give another sec that, okay, here's a question. So the question is, are ADHD medications less effective with high progesterone? So I will start that question by saying it's a really good one. I'm not gonna be able to give a very definitive answer. It's a good question. But what I can say is that ADHD is interacts with hormones in general. So it's a possibility. I definitely don't know. But there is a connection between ADHD and hormones. So I can say that. Okay. So I have a client who was recently prescribed ADHD medication. They said she'll need to do a drug test every 90 days. Does that sound typical? So I would say it's not typical. And to answer that a little more fully is that because of the class that stimulant medication is in, and that there is an abuse potential, generally that the folks who abuse ADHD medication are not the people who have ADHD. I'm sure that could happen, but for the majority that ends up not being what it is. But because of the energy around it, that there are, some providers who will have somebody do drug tests, usually that's to make sure they're actually taking it, is what the idea behind that is. It's not unusual, but I haven't seen, like, there's not a standard around it, like, meaning that, yes, that happens, it's not unusual, but not every provider does it, if that makes sense. They don't absolutely have to. All right, well, any other questions for now? Okay. Do you find that these medications help with fidgeting? They definitely can. For some people, it definitely can bring down some of those feelings of hyperactivity, and they just may not need to fidget in the same way. For some people, it's not. So it can. Ooh, this is a really good question. Okay, lots of really good questions here. So I'm gonna answer a couple more, and then we'll keep going, and there will be more room for questions. These are all really good ones, though. Okay, do you think there's higher rates of PPMD folks with ADHD? So I wish I could remember this a little more definitively, but I'm pretty sure the answer is yes, that they have seen a connection with that. I'm not 100% sure, but I feel like I've seen that. So again, there are connections with hormones and things like that. And I feel like I've seen that, but I'm not 100% sure. Okay. How do you differentiate between ADHD and just anxiety? So that's, I'm trying to think of there's gonna be a way to answer that. I may come back to that one because it's a great question and it's kind of a big one because there are really high rates of also people with ADHD having anxiety. So very well, both might be present at the same time, but being able to piece that out is a really useful thing. And some elements of anxiety can have some elements of overlap. I'm going to come back to that question and answer that one later because I'm going to think about it for a sec of a good way to explain that. It's a great question. Okay. I'm going to read these next two and then I'm going to move to the next section and we'll definitely have more time for questions, but these are all really great. Okay. So one thing that's been challenging supporting ADHD postpartum people is getting them to rest. So just want to support that I could understand that because I think there's a dual need. And I'll go into it a little bit later, but that if there is that hyperactivity, that internal restlessness, being still might feel really physically bad. So there's probably a dual element there of they're needing to rest, right, to recover, but also there may be an element of resting that just like physically feels bad or is boring. So it is a hard thing to be weighing both, and I could understand that showing up. Okay, so I'm going to read one more for now, and then I will come back to questions in a little bit. Okay, so as an IBCLC, who's also an ADHDer, I found that many prescribers are not as familiar with medications in the context of lactation. Medications and mother's milk and infant risk websites have been some resources I've shared with clients and prescribers when I'm offering collaborative care. Thank you so much for bringing that up and offering that. Those are both great resources. And I do agree that there's just a variety of knowledge around ADHD. That adult ADHD has not been, that a lot of people are a lot more familiar with childhood ADHD are less familiar with adult ADHD, and then the nuances around, you know, medication and lactation may not always be known. It's a similar element that you'll see sometimes with any sort of like psychiatric medication, like antidepressants and things. You'll also see a variety of kind of things that sometimes ways those conversations go. So I think that's a great point to be able to offer those resources if somebody just is not as up to date around the recommendations. Okay, so again, really great questions. And I'm gonna make a quick note of where I left off in the questions to answer at the next point for that, just to make sure we keep going or get through the material. But again, thank you all for the great questions. All right, and moving forward. So the next section is around ADHD, pregnancy, and postpartum. So this is where I'm going to layer some of these, you know, general elements of adult ADHD onto, you know, what does that look like when somebody's pregnant or postpartum? And I'm going to be trying to give some practical kind of ways of showing that. So here is the overview for this section. So first, a very quick review of common perinatal difficulties. I know most people who are coming to this webinar are pretty familiar with this, so I'm not gonna be going in much depth there, but just a, you know, very quick reminder, and then talking about, you know, what can come up with ADHD in the picture. And I'm gonna give some examples that are of just what can this look like? And part of that is because I think for most, you know, times that we're struggling, you know, like that a lot of us aren't going to name it in this clinical language, right? Like in people with ADHD, if things are hard, aren't necessarily going to be saying, oh, this is really hard because of my ADHD. Some might, but others, you're just going to see it show up in these other ways when people are, you know, having a hard time. Okay. So, you know, very quick reminder, and I'm sorry, I'm going to close something so I don't have it blocking before I can read. Sorry about that. Okay, back to this. So review of some really general, you know, difficulties that can show up, right? There's, you know, risk of anxiety or depression. There's a big hormonal shifts, interrupted sleep, you know, baby being difficult, you know, the birthing person, pregnant person, you know, physically feeling bad, nausea, pain, all the sort of pressures that show up, societal, friends, family, identity issues of, you know, who am I now as a parent, relationship challenges. You know, we know there's more than this, but this is, you know, a few things that we know are really common that happen during pregnancy and postpartum. And then what if ADHD is around too? You know, what can happen? So here are some different elements that can show up. One, you know, going back to the medication is that not everybody's gonna end up staying on their medication for a lot of reasons. One with, you know, where the research is, some people aren't gonna feel comfortable with that. Some people just don't wanna take medications during pregnancy or postpartum at all, no matter what it is. You know, there's a lot of reasons. There might be some people it's not recommended for whatever reason, but there's gonna be some people who aren't gonna be taking the medications who were before. And if those medications were helping, you know, obviously it's hard to not be able to be taking them. Another element is that people with ADHD are already more likely to be struggling with anxiety, depression, trauma, you know, all those other things that were listed a couple slides back. And we know that if somebody already has struggled with these, it's more likely to see it again during pregnancy or postpartum, or that those sort of elements can get harder or more intense during those time periods anyway. And then another tricky thing that can happen, and this would be for people who have ADHD, but it's undiagnosed and potentially they're not aware of it, is that it may be the anxiety or the depression that gets treated, because that's what's recognized. And that probably speaks a little to that question that was asked a bit ago of, like, you know, how to tell the difference. And there may be some help in that, right? Because, like, they probably are also feeling anxious or depressed, but it may not help as much as it could. The medication, like this antidepressant, may or may not help. It may help, but there are some people with ADHD where that just doesn't get to it because it's just not really, you know, potentially what they're needing. And then the ADHD component, which may be what's fueling the anxiety or depression, just doesn't get looked at. And then sensory difficulties, there's a lot happening sensory-wise, right, between pregnancy and birth and then having a new baby, all sorts of different things, noises, you know, all sorts of stuff going on, and that can make things hard. You're sitting a lot of the day, and that can be hard with hyperactivity or that internal restlessness. And then as far as executive functioning, there are some things that for everybody makes executive functioning harder, like, you know, sleep or stress for everybody. You know, you're not going to remember things as well if you're not getting sleep or if you're really stressed out. But with ADHD, that tends to be show up in a more kind of in a louder way. And then with hormones, the ADHD does respond to hormones. Like an example being that for a lot of people with ADHD, that if they have a menstrual cycle, that a couple days before they start their period, if they take medication, like they can find that it conks out. It just feels like they're not taking it anymore. And those are because of those hormonal fluctuations. So you can imagine then with being pregnant and giving birth that we know there's giant hormonal changes. So that in and of itself will impact potentially anyway what the ADHD kind of looks like in the executive functioning, how that looks. And then when we think about some during pregnancy, but especially postpartum, just that there's a lot more tasks to do. There's just a lot of like little new things, or little and big, new things to be doing and to be tracking. And people, they developed some sort of system to be able to kind of manage things, to, you know, be able to work and kind of get by. And that system may be working really well, and they might've been feeling really good about it, But if suddenly you bring in all these new factors, that system may kind of really not work anymore. And suddenly feeling like they can't track anything, they can't remember anything. And that can feel, you know, pretty bad if suddenly it feels like don't know how to kind of get through a day, feel very overwhelming. This last one is partially just to make sure everyone's awake, that babies are boring. But, you know, when you think about it, right, like, especially in the newborn phase, you know, babies aren't, you know, all that the babies are not talking, they're not playing. And just that this phase for people sometimes isn't the most intellectually stimulating. And with ADHD, being bored is a really uncomfortable state. It's generally more difficult than it is for people who do not have ADHD. So that is something that can be a challenge as well. Okay. So now we're going to move into, like, what does this look like? And it's getting less, it's away from like symptoms and things like that. It's just, what are some potential ways that if somebody has ADHD and they're struggling, that it might show up? And a note that most of these elements can show up other ways. Like it can show up in anxiety or just people struggling in general, but I'm going to be trying to put this lens of ADHD of like how this relates in. So one is having more negative thoughts about the self, and some examples that might show up. Like I'm thinking about postpartum here, and somebody's executive functioning is feeling really hard. They feel like they're just kind of not able to do all these different pieces that they feel like they should be able to do or they want to be able to do. So some thoughts that might come up or that do come up for some people are like, I must not be trying hard enough. Why is this so easy for everyone else? I'm a bad parent. I really am just lazy. There's something wrong with me. And these sort of thoughts are sometimes ones that struggled with when they were younger, and maybe they kind of came to peace with things when they kind of learned more about ADHD, or kind of just depending on where somebody is in their journey. But if suddenly, like, it, you know, everything just kind of feels like it's blowing up, all of these sort of thoughts can come back loud and can be really impactful. And I do want to mention that I think there's an element of this is where like ableism can come in, of like feeling like they're lazy rather than just that they have some differences here that make some things harder than maybe they are for other people. And again, that these can be old patterns that are re-arising. So some ways that, another way that this can show up is through perfectionism and indecision. And I'll go through some examples, but part of why this shows up, like when we think about it through an ADHD lens, is that if people have had various experiences in their lives where they feel like people have been telling them they've done things the wrong way, or have gotten, you know, those sort of criticisms and things, that if some of that is internalized, that the way that some people cope with that is trying to really always do things the right way. So that can show up as indecision around, you know, like how to prepare for baby, what to buy, what classes to take. And the research is not something that's fun for them. It's not like, oh, it's so interesting to look at all these different things. It's a lot of worrying about getting the right thing. And an example of what this could look like is, say somebody is wanting to buy a stroller, and they look online at all these different types of strollers, and they're doing all these different comparisons, and it's just really overwhelming. You know, how many strollers, different kinds of strollers are there? How many different qualities do you want to look at? Safety, do you want to look at how long it's going to last? And if you have a second kid, and at some point they just get overwhelmed and put it away for a while and then come back to it. But it's like a very stressful process of trying to choose like exactly which stroller to get. So that's an example of what that can look like. Can also show up as rigidity around baby's schedule. And things around that. And then comparison to peers and then social media can come up too. And that's one that, you know, comes up for most people in this time period at one point or another, but there's a different context to it that, although we can argue in general, social media is not real, that people are presenting, you know, the highlight reel and all that is true, but also there are some differences that people with ADHD have that may make that gap feel wider of these things. If people are able to do all of these things while all this is going on, and some of those things just may not be as realistic For someone with ADHD at certain times, like especially if there's not support that they're needing, or if it's particularly a time when they're not getting a lot of sleep. So again, there's a little bit of a different lens on it, even though that issue comes up with a whole lot of people anyway. So another way that it shows up is feeling overstimulated or bored. This starts getting into some of the sensory differences, ways that can show up with someone being overstimulated is having a really hard time with their baby crying, feeling touched out. And the way that, people can describe that feeling is like feeling touched out can sometimes be like a skin crawly feeling if somebody touches them. I've also heard it described as kind of like energy, there's this energy around, like going through their body with the idea of like anyone touching them again. And sometimes being overstimulated or can feel like almost pain, like it's the sensory element is just really uncomfortable to the point that it can feel painful. It can also show up as just feeling irritable or having headaches. And those are the ones that can be really subtle, that if there's something sensory going on that's too much, and that's not something that's in somebody's awareness, it can just show up as feeling irritable and having headaches and just kind of feeling gross. With being understimulated or bored, you might hear someone feeling really blah from not getting out of the house. Again, that's not just an ADHD thing, but it might be even a bigger need for somebody with ADHD. Missing talking to other adults, so not getting that intellectual stimulation. So again, like you'll hear that as someone being really bored. Or another comparison that I give, there can be like, sometimes putting words to these experiences can be a little tough, but like when I think about the uncomfortable element of understimulation or bored, when you think about the idea of like being a place that's just too quiet and it's just uncomfortable because how quiet it is, that's a little bit of how I think about some of this with the understimulation. And the other component that I want to mention here is how it can show up around that restlessness, that hyperactivity element that when you think about especially early postpartum, and this, speaks to one of the comments that was in the chat earlier, that we're not going to, that generally people are going to be in the house or their apartment more. They are going to be sitting more because they're needing to recover. And if there's a decent amount of like that internal restlessness that they experience, it can just feel really bad. It can make them feel irritable, physically uncomfortable. And again, it's something that feels a lot like anxiety. And that exact, the exact line there, again, I'll go into a little bit later, but I think of it as mimicking anxiety in that way. All right, so I will go ahead and look at the chat again and start answering questions. And if anybody wanted to answer a question by video, that's fine too, but whatever people's preferences are good for me. Okay. There is a connection between PMDD and ADHD. Has there been a connection between those and PMDD? I think, unfortunately, there might be a word missing there. Particularly curious about the rage component of PMDD. Oh, I see. I'm missing a letter there. Okay. Sorry. I'm going to read that again. Is there a connection between PMDD and ADHD? Has there been a connection between those and PPMD, so postpartum mood disorders? Particularly curious about the rage component and PMDD and the rage and PPMD. Let's see. This is a really good question. I think I'm gonna go ahead and skip it for now just because I'm not the answer that I think it's gonna take me a little bit to articulate that one. So I'm gonna go ahead and skip it for now. It is a good question though. Okay. Is there a connection between ADHD and complex PTSD? So great question. Also a little bit of a complicated one. There is generally higher rates of PTSD and trauma for people who have ADHD. I can say like what I have kind of seen and heard is that I would say I don't know for sure. It's another one where I wouldn't say like I'd be able to say very definitively, but I think there's likely to be a higher instance of complex PTSD with people with ADHD. It just seems to kind of be the trend in a lot of these elements, but I don't know for sure. There might be folks here who know that information more clearly. Okay, with adult ADHD diagnosis, there also needs to be criteria met of symptoms having been present as a child as well. So yes, the criteria right now, I believe, says that symptoms have to have been present, I believe, by 12. It's somewhere around there. I believe it used to be younger and they have raised that. And it does need to have shown up in more than one area. It doesn't have to be even, like meaning if it was looking at school and at home, that for the criteria, it needs to have shown itself in multiple areas. It just doesn't have to be exactly even because sometimes the way the ADHD presents and how somebody feels in a certain setting or ability to mask or like, purposely tone down or hide elements can show up in certain settings. So even with the criteria, it doesn't have to be equal, but the idea would be it would be showing up in some way in more than one setting. Okay. So does this look different in relation to gender, birthing parent versus co-parent? Great question. One element that I meant to mention, and I apologize for not, is that this presentation is focusing on the birthing parent, and that's partially just for the amount of time that we have. And because that person is also going through these hormonal changes, so it seemed to make sense to focus on that person. So the answer is pretty much yes, it can look different in regards to gender, birthing parent versus co-parent. But there certainly still could be things that are difficult with ADHD being present for any of those people. It's just obvious, obviously if somebody gives birth, there's that component. There's all these other elements like the medical components and the hormones coming into play. But say for a partner or co-parent who has ADHD, there's still a ton more tasks and it could still be a very difficult time period for them. So definitely could still It definitely can still have an impact. It would just be a little bit different. And ADHD does look different, can show itself differently with gender as well. So the answer to that is yes, it can look different for all those things. Okay. So RSD is the rejection sensitive dysphoria. And I mentioned it very briefly in the first section around kind of emotional elements that can come up with ADHD. I am not going to be going into a lot of detail around it for this presentation. It definitely is something that can be very impactful for people. And it's definitely worth, it's a time element really that I'm not going to be going into it more here. But it is certainly something that can be very impactful for people. And again, that's that response to rejection or feeling criticized, and it can be a very impactful sort of experience, but I won't be going into it more today. Let's see. So I've seen moms with schedule rigidity, but not as much with dads with ADHD. I definitely could see that. I think that moms are the ones that tend to be, I'm sure this is not universal, but you know, what I've seen is moms tend to be the ones that are kind of searching out the materials around parenting guides and things, and I find fall more into that. Doesn't mean that a dad couldn't, I just don't see as many dads researching that. So it makes sense to me that you would see that more with mom. The indecision and researching coming from fear can also combine with a common struggle of ADHDers in money management, resulting in increasing debt issues, during postpartum from impulsive purchases, from fear and excessive insomnia, and researching. That's a really great point, that money difficulties can be really common with folks with ADHD, and that can certainly contribute to anxiety and indecision around purchases. It makes a lot of sense, and it's a great point. Okay, I'm gonna read one more before, I'll do two more real quickly, and then we'll jump to the next section. Okay. Do you find that emotional dysregulation is something that becomes more difficult during this time? I find that, it's a good question. What I can say is I find that in general, that it's just a, you know, when there's so much going on for anybody, that it's just, you know, emotions can be high. It's a good question around if that particular element looks different with ADHD in this time period. That I'm not sure. What I can say is when I was, you know, preparing for this webinar and trying to look up research, I was not finding much of any research that's specific to ADHD and pregnancy and postpartum and what that all looks like. There was like a little bitty bit. I definitely didn't see any research on it. So what I can say is that I see it in general. I don't know if that's related to ADHD or not. That's a great question. And is there a comorbidity with insomnia? I believe that all sorts of different sleep disorders are highly correlated with ADHD. I don't know that in a ton of detail, but I do know there's a lot of differences there. So is it exactly insomnia or not? I'm not sure, but it is more common for people with ADHD to have sleep disorders and things like that. Okay. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and continue to make sure we get to this last part where I'm gonna go more into suggestions and things, but all really great questions. I appreciate them all, thank you. Okay. All right, and I'm gonna adjust my screen one more time before we keep going. All right. So this last section is strategies to support pregnant and postpartum clients with ADHD. And the way I have this one structured is through, I created an ADHD perinatal wellness plan. And the idea is that that could be something that could be looked at in pregnancy or during postpartum. And I introduced that and then go through it in pieces. And then I'm weaving some helpful ADHD themes throughout with perinatal examples. And the idea of the themes is that, like, the examples I'm giving are just some ones that either I have thought of or ones that people I've worked with have done and have worked well, or things that I've read about. But it's meant to get you thinking about it more than, okay, these are the exact things to do. And with ADHD, it's often more helpful to think of it more in this general way of like, oh, what is kind of this picture of what's going on and what might help support them than the exact technique. Hopefully that'll make more sense as we go in a minute. Okay, so here are the three sections of this ADHD perinatal wellness plan that I'll be discussing. And so professional support needs, basic needs through an ADHD lens, and then this last one that I've called sensory sitting and boredom, which kind of is how it sounds. Okay, so professional support needs, this isn't, you know, just related to ADHD, but that if somebody is on medications, that it's really, again, helpful to make sure that they're having a conversation with whoever's prescribing around it. Because what I'm looking for there, like what I'm listening for is, like, if somebody's deciding to go off their medication, you know, I'm not a prescriber, I'm not gonna be necessarily giving an opinion on that, but I wanna make sure that they've talked to somebody, because sometimes you will hear that somebody made an assumption, like, oh, I just assumed that you can't take this when you're pregnant or postpartum, you know, or when you're feeding, and so I just went off. And that's the kind of thing that I'm listening for, is I wanna make sure that they've actually talked to somebody about it, that it's not an assumption, that they have all the information, and then they can decide what's right for them. Of course, like, if it makes sense, a mental health therapist can be really helpful here, you know, someone in the perinatal area, if they happen to know about ADHD as well, that's a plus, of course, because ADHD, again, is something that there's a lot of nuance to it. Unless someone's kind of done a deep dive, it's kind of easy to misunderstand certain elements. And then if it's depending on kind of where somebody is in their own ADHD journey, learning more about ADHD can be really helpful if someone has the brain space for it, whether it's doing some reading, you know, audiobooks are always great for this, or there's YouTube channels, just reading online of other ADHDers and what helps them. The more that people kind of learn about it, learn about themselves, one can bring in compassion for when things are hard, and two can just get more ideas around how to help them. So this next part is thinking about basic needs through an ADHD lens. Like, again, most of these things would probably be helpful for anybody, but we're just going to focus on what that looks like with ADHD. So in general, you know, we know that sleep is important for everybody with ADHD, even more so, things are just even harder without sleep. So some sort of plan there, if possible, if there's a partner involved or any sort of support, that someone's getting some chunk of sleep. And that's not going to look, that's going to look pretty similar to probably a recommendation for anybody, but just knowing that that sleep component is really important. Another element to think about, I think a lot about like making sure, and this would be for both parents really, but again, focusing on the birthing parent for a moment, that making sure that the parents are eating. Like one element with ADHD, it's not for, not with everybody, but that some people with ADHD just generally have a tendency towards forgetting to eat or go kind of long periods of time without eating anyway. Sometimes that can be because of medication. Stimulant medication has an appetite suppressing element to it, so people don't realize they're hungry. And also sometimes people also just don't realize they're hungry anyway or get really busy with something. And we know during postpartum that a lot of parents have, there's so much going on that they're not necessarily eating super regularly anyway. So spending some time thinking about how they're going to get that need met can be really useful. It can be thinking of like what's going to be easy really for either parent. Is that going to be freezing meals and having that ready? Thinking about that sort of thing, but also what are kind of foods that are can be kind of kept out that will have some nutrients and taste good and things. And I'm going to go into that a little bit more in a minute, but also having food and water like out and visible. And here, when I'm saying feeding stations, I'm thinking about like wherever the baby is getting fed to have like a basket with various snacks that are all appealing and having a water bottle. And if possible, having somebody else like, you know, maybe more than one person trying to make sure the water bottle stays full and is there. So that is just right there and easy and accessible. Having a plan around tracking information. I'll go into that more in a minute. And really thinking about the different daily tasks that are involved, particularly postpartum with diapering and feeding. And if there's ways to kind of reduce the amount of steps and finding something that's really going to work for them. I'm going to go into more detail around that in just a minute. Okay. So this is the first principle or theme that I'm bringing in. I'm trying to just be playful with the names here. I wouldn't necessarily, you know, talk to somebody and say, we're going to have you try not to remember anything, but just trying to be playful and have it be memorable. So first one here is to, you know, don't try to remember anything. In general, it is a helpful thing ADHD to get information out of the head and written down somewhere rather than trying to remember. It comes back to that working memory difference. And again, with, you know, pregnancy and especially postpartum, there's just so much to track. There's doctor's appointments, there's potentially medications. If birthing parent is taking medications or maybe even the baby is, tracking the diaper changes at the beginning, feeding times, or maybe how much baby's feeding, all those things, that's a lot of information and that can be very overwhelming. So finding some way to track that. And that can be apps. I know there, I'm not going to give examples because I know there's probably a lot of different good ones out there. So there can be apps both for tracking like the baby stuff, like diapers and feeding and things like that. There are good apps for medications that can even put on reminders. So that way there's not a worry about, well, did I actually take that medication or not? Among everything else to be able to track that. And for any sort of tracking, well, maybe not the medication, but for these other sort of tracking, it's really helpful if there's a way that it's linked, that another partner, that a partner could access it as well. And that could be through, like, you know, an app, can also be shared calendars, things like that. And if technology is not as either accessible or desired, any of this could be paper. You could have a paper calendar, you could have some sort of notebook that goes back and forth. But again, a system that's thought of beforehand, and trying to get information into that system as quickly as possible, meaning like if you're at the doctor's office and they schedule the next appointment, get that into the calendar, like at the doctor's office, don't wait to get to the car. It just, that information may not, you may not remember to put it into the system between that gap of time. Okay, so the next one is to simplify and reduce tasks whenever you can. And I have a couple examples here. Some of the examples I have involve having to buy some extra things, and that may or may not be accessible for everybody, but the idea is to just kind of get your mind going on what this can look like. An example would be like if there's a parent who is pumping overnight and needs to do that a couple times, if it's possible to have a mini fridge closer to where they pump, like if that makes sense for them to be able to put like the milk right in the fridge and not have to go, you know, down the hall or downstairs or wherever the main kitchen refrigerator is, it saves that extra task. And anything that saves that extra step will leave a little bit more executive functioning energy to do something else and reduce some stress. So some other examples here is like thinking about diapering decisions like cloth versus disposable. I know there's a lot of ecological elements there to think about, but also really thinking about the needs there of the parents of if there are extra steps for one, is that something that's going to feel realistic? Is that going to add extra stress to their day? So having that as a factor. And one element here that I do find is that with these sort of things that there can sometimes be this feeling of like, oh, I shouldn't need to do this. Like I shouldn't have to do this extra thing. Like I should be able to do this extra step. I definitely can see that come up sometimes with this. And those are times when try to reassure people that we're really just wanting to work with your brain. There's not any fault here in, you know, needing to do things in a potentially a little bit different way than maybe friends do, or things like that. So main message again is to find ways to simplify and reduce tasks as much as is realistic or that you can. Another theme that is really useful is having things visible. And that also comes back to the working memory differences, that having things out and visible is just a really helpful cue and to either be able to do something or remember there's an appointment. And some examples here are, like when I talked about having some sort of tracking system, like say one of them is a joint calendar. A lot of people do joint Google calendars and will put events there. There are some devices that you can get that's like a screen and it will show that shared calendar. And if you put that in kind of a high traffic area, an area that is walked past frequently, it can be really helpful to like be able to just see that calendar without having to think about it. It's like, oh, I'm walking by and I'm looking at that. And oh yeah, there's an appointment tomorrow. So again, it's just less to have to try to remember or even have somebody else in the family queue because you're seeing it. And again, it can be something like a screen, but it can also be a whiteboard. It can be a paper calendar, whatever works, but having things out. And the keep it visible element is also why I was mentioning earlier around having food at the baby feeding station, is it also just helps the parent remember to eat because they're gonna be feeding the baby several times a day. If they're sitting there and there's a bunch of snacks, they're more likely to be like, oh yeah, I haven't eaten in a while. Like I should have a snack now. So it's also in that keep it visible. And this is just a really useful one with ADHD in general. It can be applied in all sorts of different ways. Okay, so this one is, you know, thinking about that sensory sitting and boredom element. This one kind of is what it sounds like, but it's either thinking ahead or if it's happening around what the needs might be there and what might help. So like when we think about sensory needs, there's a bunch of different examples here that I'll go through some of them. For the sake of this presentation, I'm thinking about whether somebody needs like more or less of these different sensory elements. So with sound, like say the sound of the baby crying is really very difficult for somebody, like there are earplugs that we can get that will reduce the sound that are actually designed that you can still hear the baby, you can still hear people talking. It just brings down the general amount of noise that's happening. With touch, if somebody's touched out, there's some elements of like if there's support, of course, to have somebody else hold the baby when possible to give a little break from there. If there's any element around sensations, like when changing diapers or putting on creams, gloves can be an option there. For taste and texture, that goes back to this theme that we're bringing up of really wanting to make sure the parents eat, that texture is an element that comes up a lot in ADHD, that oftentimes what that looks like or what people have been told is like, oh, you're a picky eater. And oftentimes that comes down to texture issues, and that can show up for any kind of food. It can be fruit, vegetables, meat, usually things that don't have a consistent texture. More processed food tends to have more consistent texture. But when that texture element is there, and that is not feeling good, then that means that that food is not going to be very appealing. And it can change day to day. There can be days where that texture is more okay or actually feels pretty good, and a day where it's like, this is a no-go. And I mention that because if that's an element that comes up, it's helpful to think about like, what are the foods where somebody can eat pretty consistently? Like normally there's going to be some sort of food that is like, oh yeah, I could eat that every day. And there's going to be other foods that are kind of the maybes. So having like easy to access foods that are just, you don't have to prepare necessarily, like protein shakes, bars, granola bars, and that are ones that are tend to be pretty consistent than somebody will eat. And as far as visual, I was kind of going for both like lights and just variety of what people are seeing. So with lights, like having some variety around how bright it is, or if somebody's overwhelmed thinking about, is it helpful to have like the lights lower or be dark for a little bit? For some people that can really help when they're feeling overwhelmed. And as far as kind of what they're seeing, it could be thinking about like, is it possible to just be aware of sitting either in a different part of the house, or if that's not possible, even a different chair or couch, so they're seeing something different, at least can help a little bit with that variety. Okay. So this section is around keeping the body and mind active. And this goes back to the element of just needing to move more and needing like and not feeling very good in the body if you don't. So this would be, of course, like you want to balance that idea of rest. But when it does make sense that person can be moving around more, it would be, you know, like encouraging them to do something that makes sense for them, whether it be going for a walk. If a baby, you know, baby carrier can be a good option to be able to move around more, be hands-free. Baby and parent yoga classes or exercise classes. Walking around Target is one that I can say comes up a lot for me, for my clients. It's a lot of people like Target. It's accessible. It can be relatively easy. So walking around Target can be a good one. And also fidget toys. And this would be less for the going out, but the when sitting for a while, like having some sort of fidget toy can help that having to sit for a while feel a little bit less uncomfortable for people. And that could be any fidget toy they like. And then as far as kind of keeping the mind active, because again, being bored with ADHD can feel very uncomfortable. Be looking into what activities might be appealing to them, which could be, you know, books, which could be an audiobook, maybe saving some TV or movies to have available. It could be games like Sudoku, word puzzles, phone games, but figuring out, you know, like what can be done that'd be kind of interesting for them, like while they're sitting, potentially with one hand. And it can be a helpful thing to think about beforehand to just, you know, help them feel not so bored and feel like their mind's still engaged with things and can really help people feel a little bit better. Okay, so this is just putting all of that together, these three different sections of all these different elements that can either be thought of in advance or while it's happening to offer support in these different areas. Okay, so that is the end of where this presentation is, and I'd be happy to answer some more questions with the time that we have. So I'm gonna go ahead and go through some more questions in the chat. And if anybody, of course, wants to ask a question, you are more than welcome to do that as well. Okay. Let me see where we are. Okay. Oops, sorry, I lost where my question was. Okay, so one person asked, can you recommend a good book for adults parenting with ADHD? And the person below mentioned a really great YouTube channel, which is How to ADHD. That is one I definitely recommend. It's not a book, I'll get back to the book suggestion, but it's very accessible information that, you know, a lot of the videos aren't that long, but they're very informative. So again, that's called How to ADHD. And there's a ton of different videos there. As far as a good book for adults parenting with ADHD, I wish I knew one. I can talk about general ADHD books, but there may be ones that I haven't come across. I also want to be clear there. But there aren't any that I know offhand that focuses on parenting and ADHD, or at least not one that I've read. So unfortunately, I'm not able to recommend that. Like ADHD 2.0 can be pretty good with just getting a sense around ADHD in general, but it's not focusing on parenting. But if anybody does know a book on ADHD adults and parenting, feel free to put it in the chat if I'm just missing something there. When thinking about simplifying tasks, et cetera, think of place of performance and keeping all tools and needs for that task within arm's reach of its execution. That's definitely really great that being able to have everything just right there makes it a lot easier to be able to do the thing. I like that. Batch prepping formula is another option. It's also more financially accessible and reduces the risk associated with formula makers. Thank you. That is a wonderful example. And I don't know a lot about formula makers, so if that's not a great suggestion, then just kind of know that there might be better ways like batching formula. Fidget toys might be a helpful option alongside the phone, which can possibly interfere more with bonding. Yeah, fidget toys are a really great one. Like one I have heard of people, I think I technically call it a fidget toy, and would be that I've had people talk about using Rubik's cubes before. I feel like it'd be hard to do with one hand, but maybe there'd be a way to make it work. But I can see that one be really engaging and also kind of keep your hands busy. But I think fidget toys are great, and there's all sorts of different ones. Please have caution when recommending phone games with screen stimulation and addiction issues for ADHDers. That's a fair point. Thank you for mentioning that. Let's see. Okay. Neurodiverse affirming adult ADHD books for professional and novices. Again, ADHD 2.0 is a pretty good one. There is one that I'm probably going to get the name wrong, but I really like, it's pretty gendered. It is written towards women. I wish I could remember the name. It's something around like a radical guide for ADHD for women. It's something like that. I think if you Google that, you'll find out what the actual name is. That one is my favorite. It's very gendered, but the information there, I really like. So those are two, at least as a starting point. Ah, thank you, Joy. A radical guide for women with ADHD. Oops, I'm gonna, the chat moved on me. A radical guide for women with ADHD. Embrace neurodiversity, live boldly, and break through barriers. So that is the name of the book. It is really wonderful. It is less on giving like specific ideas. It's not one that if somebody wants, okay, I want hacks for ADHD, that's not going to be the book to read, but it's a really wonderful, like giving a philosophy around this experience of ADHD. Again, it's focusing in on women for that book. Okay. We've often helped clients get their homes cleaned up and then took pictures, which we laminated, so the client can visualize how they want their room area space. It's helped with somebody who struggles with feeling overwhelmed and they've gotten behind on keeping up with household duties. It's a great idea. Thank you for mentioning that. All right. Any other questions come to mind? These have all been really good ones.
And we probably have time for one more question if anybody has it. And if not, we can start to wrap up.
Perfect.
I have a quick question. What did I hear correctly that there was going to be some kind of toolkit or something or that we might be able to access after this training? Or was that just your intro to some of the like interventions or things to keep in mind with clients with ADHD?
It's probably more of the intro, but a project that I'm wanting to do is kind of make that ADHD, that perinatal guide that I was kind of using as a structure for that last section. I am wanting to make that form fuller to be able to actually be used by people. So you're welcome to email me and I could email you when I get to that. I'm planning on making that just to be something that can be a resource for people. Because it was something that I was looking around when I was researching this and was not finding. I was asking around and so I'm like, I'm just gonna make something that makes sense to me. But I'd be happy that once I actually get that as a fuller document to share that. So you'd be welcome to email me and I can get it to you when I get to that.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
It's 1:30, so I want to thank you, Jane, for your time and expertise. We're going to formally close the webinar. And if anyone has any other questions or things, Jane said that she can stay for just a couple of more moments and answer those. So I'm going to stop the